Mina Lee Grubbin coming to you today with Faithful Walk Healing Ministries, and I hope everyone is doing great this evening. Happy New Year to you all. Today is Monday, January 6th of 2020. So we've crossed over into a new year. And today I would like to bring you all a word that the Lord has given me for this year, prophecy or a prophetic word, I should say, for this year. I'm going to try to cover a lot of ground today, but try to concentrate it enough for you all to all catch and be able to process everything God has given me. We've crossed over into a very prophetically significant year, and not so much as probably what you all, some of you all at least, have already begun to hear. Probably words in regards to prosperity and blessings and shifts in the paradigms and all of that good stuff. This is a severely prophetic year in regards to the end times, the end of the age, and what's at hand. So the first thing that I want to tell you all this evening, the first thing I want to talk about is the fact that the Lord told me several weeks ago now that 2020 would be the year of the sword, the year of the sword. And when he first began telling me this, what I kept hearing him talking about was a scripture quoted in Matthew where he talks about, and two will be in the field and one will be taken and the other one left. And two would be riding at the mill, and one would be taken and the other would be left. And some of you, if not all of you, are familiar with that scripture. People have had different interpretations of what it meant when Jesus said this, but this is what I heard. So I automatically assumed that this was going to be the scripture that he would give me in regards to the word for this year, but in fact it wasn't. He gave me a different scripture. And that scripture was Matthew chapter 13. So I'm not going to delay too much that scripture. I'm going to open up and tell you what it is that the Lord wanted me to share with you all. And then from there, it'll basically set a platform for where we're going to go with this in this video and the things that he wants me to share with you, the warnings that he wants me to share with you today. So I'm going to open up with Matthew chapter 13. And I'm actually going to start at verse 3. And this is the parable about the seeds, the sower into the fields. And most of you probably are familiar with it. And I'm going to tell you exactly what the Lord gave me and how it relates to where we're going into this year. So I'm reading out of the New King James Version. If you all want to follow along with me, then that's fine. And it says, then he spoke to many things to them in the parable, saying, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. And some fell into stony places where they did not have much earth. And they immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good soil and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. He who has ears, let them hear. Now I'm going to skip ahead to verse 18, just so you'll know. Therefore, and Jesus begins to explain the interpretation or give the interpretation of the parable. Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches it away, what was sown in his heart. This is he who receives seed by the wayside. But he who receives seed on the stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. Now he who received the seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he who received seed on the good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Okay. So I want to stop right there. And so this is what the Lord has given me for the body of Christ in 2020. And it's in regards to this. So we have people who, of course, the seed that fell by the wayside, which that's very explainable as far as the enemy coming and taking it away. But the three that the Lord really wanted me to focus on is those who fell by the good soil, those who fell among the thorns, and those who fell on the rocky soil. I'm going to start backwards with the rocky soil and where it pertains to 2020. Because as I said to you, the Lord said that this would be the year of the sword. And the sword would come. You know, Jesus said he did not come to bring peace, but a sword. And he said that sword would separate mother from daughter, son from father, in-law from in-law. He even said that your worst enemies would be the members of your household. And even that terminology, household, it's not just your house, the people that live in your house at your address, but even in a spiritual sense, the church, that you would have enemies within the household. That even means those who call themselves Christians, those who go to the same church with you or the same congregation or fellowship, those who sit at your table, who calls themselves friend or even brother, that even your worst enemies will be those that were what you would consider to be under the same roof, in the same platform, the same denomination, the same faith, the same belief as you. Okay, and that's what it means. And so this year, what we saw really in the beginning, honestly, in 2019 in the sense, but in this year, we will see people begin to rise against each other in ways we have never seen before, saints, even within the church. We're already in a divisive state. This country has already been divided. I'm saying is to say that we already have begun to see these things, but even more so, it will increase this year and going forward, okay? And in the process of this sword that is coming down, that the Lord is him himself, it's not Satan who is bringing this sword, but it's Christ. It is him, he himself, which he prophesied he would do. You know, he did not come to bring this unity. We're under this illusion that we're going to come together in unity and that this will usher in the coming of the Lord. There are actual sects of teachings and churches and even denominations that actually teach this and practices that we are all going to come together. This is not true. This is going against everything that was prophesied regarding the end of the age, the end times, even the tribulation. There would be much separation. And the Lord is saying this is what is upon us. But for us, the individual question you need to ask yourself is, where do you stand? Where is your seed? Are you the seed that's planted among the thistles or thorns? Are you the seed planted amongst the rocky soil? Are you planted on the good soil? And one of the things I wanted to point out again was when he talked about the stony soil in verse 20. Again, I'm going to just repeat it, where he says, but he who received the seed on the stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation and persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. The Lord really had me to focus on this one because, saints, I want to just tell you right now, we're living in a time where a lot of Western churchgoers or Western Christians, American Christians even, if I want to specify it, we are on rocky soil. A lot of people don't even realize they're on rocky soil. And the reason why is because good times are here. They want good times, or they're just comfortable. They're comfortable in their lifestyle. Where we as Americans, we are comfortable. I've said again and again that we don't really know what it's like to be persecuted. We think that we equate persecution to someone talking to us, talking about us on our jobs, or even potentially getting us fired. We equate persecution to the neighbors not liking us, or people talking about us at school, or the pastor not liking us, or we attribute tribulation to not being able to pay a light bill, or not having enough food in our refrigerator, or maybe even dealing with a sickness. Okay. And I'm not saying that these things cannot bring stress, but saints, I'm gonna just be very honest with you. That is nothing compared to what our brothers and sisters in other countries are going through. It's nothing compared to such. They don't even begin to have half the luxuries that we have, the luxury of just constant electricity, or even running water, or being able to just drive to the corner to get as many groceries as you want, or going into the grocery store and having the options of multiple types of foods, or breads, or meats, or cheeses, or things that people don't have that in a lot of countries. You know, America is spoiled. We are spoiled, and we've become complacent, and the church itself has become complacent. And we are in a compromising state as the majority. And it is the reason why judgment has been brought and is being brought upon this country, even as we speak, saints, because we have gone to sleep. We've gone into a drunken slumber as a church. And on top of that, because we're so comfortable, we don't want to believe that anything else will continue except such. We don't want to hear about judgment. We don't want to fathom the idea that our conveniences are going to be or may be taken away from us. But I'm coming to tell you today, saints, in January of 2020, I'm here to tell you today that those things are coming to an end in this country. Your conveniences, your things that make you comfortable, the things that you pleasure, your luxuries, they're coming to an end, saints, because God is sharpening his sword. The judge is about to stand. Elohim is about to stand, saints, and he is a just God, and he renders justice. And the Bible tells us that it is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And so he's coming to render his justice upon America. He's going to render justice for the millions of babies that have been killed in our country, saints. Just to point it out, just on a side note, they put out the statistics for 2019. Now, this is worldwide, but I just want you to know that in 2019, 42.4 million pregnancies ended in abortion. Saints, can you imagine 42.4 million pregnancies ended through abortion in 2019, and that's worldwide. Here in America, we still sit at a staggering 800,000 abortions. And even though they said that that's down from the previous years, you only give statistics every 3 years. The previous record was 900,000. But actually, the number between the two was about 60,000. So 60,000 less abortions from 3 years prior, which we give honor and praise to God for. But say still, we're still sitting at over 800,000 abortions in this country. That's still close to a million. That's still close to a million babies in 1 year that were killed, murdered. And that blood is poured upon the soil. And that blood is crying out for justice, saints. And God will judge. He will judge. And so those who are in the church who are asleep, those who are under a drunken slumber of complacency, of becoming stagnant, there's no longer flowing waters coming through us because we've gotten into our place. We have this arrival mentality where we believe, in a sense, subconsciously, that God owes us something. Let me tell you something, saints. God does not owe us anything. He does not owe you anything. He does not owe me anything. He does not owe this nation anything except judgment. He does not owe us blessings or anything. He doesn't. He's God. He can do what he wants. But when you look at a whole, the sin and the corruption and the perversion and the greed and the murder that has taken place in this country over the years, and it has not gotten better. There's little bits and pieces here and there. You want to talk about this president? Sure, let's talk about the last 3 years. The last 3 years, the president has done little pieces here and there, but on a whole, the murder is still increasing. The abortions are still being done. Brother has turned against brother. There's racial division in this country. There's division within the church. There's division within politics. There is so much that's still going on. The idolatry is still going on. The greed is still going on. The thievery is still going on. The pornography is still advancing. The sex trafficking has not gotten any better. The abuse of our children has not gotten any better. The abuse of women has not gotten any better, saints. I could go on and on. But the fact of the matter is, we are still living in a staggering amount of sin and perversion and filth and iniquities, and our cups are full. But the Lord is saying for the church, specifically addressing the church, we need to make sure we are not on rocky soil. That rocky soil where people, they receive the word, and we can be in churches, we can be out of churches, listening on YouTube, listening to Bible studies or groups or prayer groups, whatever, whoever, whatever you belong to, however you fellowship, it doesn't matter. And you could be one that receives the word. You could be hearing this word right now and be saying, oh yes, this is a confirmation. This is exactly everything in my spirit that I want. But at the same time, what is your personal, where is your personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Where does it stand, saints? That is the question. They have no root. They had no root. You know why? Because saints were too busy on social media. We're too busy caught up in our laptops and our iPhones and our Samsungs and our Androids and our iPads and all of these things that we have, you know, computers and gaming, television, Netflix, Amazon Prime, whatever it is. We're so caught up in these things. We're on Periscope and Pinterest and Twitter and YouTube and Facebook and all of these different things, Snapchat, and there's all these different ones, and they keep coming out with more and more stuff, okay, to distract you, to cause you to be looking down. One of my good friends, we did a Watchman on the Wall on the 31st of December. Some of you all may have had the opportunity to tune into that, but she talks about how the Lord showed her. She was taken up into the air. She was looking down all and observing all of the people up on earth, and their heads were all bowed. Their heads were bowed in their devices, their electronical devices. And the Lord spoke to her and he said, look at them. Look at what they're doing. He said, they're not going to make, he says, it's not my word to say, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. He said, they're not even looking up. He said, they're looking down at their phones. They're looking down at their electronics, their technology, their gadgets, and they're not even looking up for me. They're not even looking up to see the signs of my coming. And because of that, they're going to miss it. I had her to share that because the Lord has been pressing on me about the addiction to social media and the church. I'm going to say specifically in the church. This is not addressing the world. But I have seen so many countless people that are Christians that are literally just addicted to Facebook, YouTube. The people who even say, go as far as saying, this is my only means of socializing. How is that when Jesus said, go into the world and preach the gospel and make disciples of men? We're so stuck on Facebook and we don't even know our neighbors, saints. We never spoken to our neighbors. We don't know who if they're hurting, if they're even saved, if they're in despair or distress, saints, because we're stuck in our devices. We're not talking to one another anymore. We're not talking to our neighbors. We don't know what's going on in our neighborhood. We don't know the children down the street. We don't speak to the people at the checkout lines and the grocery stores and the supermarkets and the malls, saints. We're so stuck on our devices. We sit at home at the table, if you even do that, at dinner time, and we got phones in our hands and we're all looking at our phones, saints, and it's a distraction. Technology has replaced faith. Technology has replaced faith. And I'm not here, I'm not saying that you can't use these media outlets as means of witnessing, but you have to ask yourself, is your social media getting more attention than God? If you sit there and just put yourself, take a survey for yourself, find out how much time you spent on social media today. Was it an hour? Was it 2 hours total? I'm talking about all the times you've gone back and forth to check your Facebook status in between your phone calls and your breaks and your lunches and driving home from work, or whether you're at home and you've clicked on it and clicked on it and clicked on it, or you're constantly putting out 10 and 12 posts a day and pictures and liking and commenting and arguing and debating and fighting online. And you have to ask yourself, how much of that time did you put in prayer? If you spent 2 hours on social media today, did you spend 2 hours in prayer? Did you spend an hour in prayer? Did you spend an hour in your word, meditating, giving thanks to God, being still before God? David said in Psalm 40, verse 1, he said, I waited patiently upon the Lord, and I waited patiently for him to answer me and incline his ear unto me. A lot of us, we do not patiently wait on the Lord, and therefore we don't even know his voice. We go find his voice on a YouTube video. We listen for things that our ears like to hear. And that could be a variety of things. It doesn't necessarily have to be like hyper grace. It could be about the end time. We go look and search for stuff. We listen and click and click and click and click and click. But the question is, are you in your secret place? Jesus said, go into your secret place and close the door behind you. And how often are we doing that? See, that's how you're going to be able to be rooted in Christ. This is the only way you're going to be able to be rooted in Christ, saints. Other than that, you can like a video, you can comment, you can share it, you can praise God all day after leaving a service and be cheerful and joyful about the sermon that your pastor preached, or a great prayer meeting that you attended, or fellowship, or whatever the case may be. But if you are not rooted in the rock, remember, he talks about the house that was built upon the rock. Remember that? He says, and when the storm came, he didn't say if the storm came. He said when the storm came. The wind and the rain pounded on the house, but the house was not moved. Okay? Because it was built upon the rock. The Bible tells us that Christ is our rock. He is our chief cornerstone. When God talks about how the time would come in Hebrews chapter 12, where he would shake both the heavens and the earth so that only the unshakable things would remain. What is unshakable, saints? The rock, which is Jesus Christ. It is unshakable. It is unmovable. But if we are built on rocky soil, not hewn in the rock, but built on rocky soil where we have no root, we cannot take root. Then the Bible tells us, Jesus clearly stated that when the tribulation comes, and when I say tribulation, when he's talking about tribulation in this, he's not talking about the 3.5 years or 7 years, whichever one you want to rain off of, that John is talking about in the book of Revelation. But the definition of tribulation is trials, persecutions, hard times, a trying time, a time of refinement, a time of even chaos and confusion. He said, when those times come and when you are persecuted because of the word, that word is the word of God, we will not be able to stand. We're out here all the time talking about how we'll die for Jesus. But I see so many in the church that can't live for him. If you cannot live for him today, saints, you will not die for him tomorrow. And the Lord wants us to focus on this. Again, the parable of the seeds, where are you? We talk about the thorns, those who were planted amongst the thorns. He said, the lure of wealth. We got so many of these so-called pastors, but I'm going to specify a lot of so-called prophets that are out here today. But all they always talk about is money. Money, money, money. Every year it's about money, prosperity, how much money you can sow your whole month's salary and give it as first fruits in January, which doesn't exist. First fruits is in the spring. Okay? But they'll tell you, oh, you got to sow so you can get in abundance and prophesying $1 million and prophesying this and that. And that's based on the God of this world. And let me tell you something. In America, we flock to that. Let me tell you, you go into a prophetic meeting, I should say, not even a conference, a meeting, or a prophet that stands up in Africa, or a prophet that stands up in India or Pakistan or Nepal, or the underground church in China, or the underground church in Iran or Saudi Arabia, or other countries in Nigeria, you do not see them saying, prophesy money, 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 money. No, not the real ones. They're not prophesying those things, saints. But you come into this Western church, the Western influence, and we're always talking about money. But Jesus told us that the love of money is the root of all evil. We got these pastors out here, they're charging for everything. Everything, every prophecy has a price to it. They tell you a little bit, then they got to sell you a book. They got to sell you a DVD. They got to sell you a CD. Well, I'll tell you the rest if you give us this money. You know, you're trying to understand the word. You're trying to get a teaching. Well, then they charge you for live streaming. They charge you to come to their conferences. They charge you for seats. Well, I've been seeing this the last several years, but I just seen it again. People doing this prophetic conference, come and hear what the Lord is saying this year about 2020, and then you have to pay a fee. You got to pay $60. You got to pay $90. You got to pay $100. Why do I have to pay money to hear what God is saying for this year? Why? It is the merchandising of the gospel. It is the very thing that Jesus took a leather cord, some say a stick, and went in and chased out the money changers in the temple. He told them, he said, this is a house of prayer, and you have turned it into a den of thieves. And so many churches have been turned into a den of thieves. You know, it's one thing to take up an offering or for people to want to give for being blessed in your ministry, that's fine. But when you're selling, everything is a sale. I can't hear the word unless I purchase something from you. That is merchandising the gospel. That is thievery. You have turned God and the word of God into a prostitute. You're prostituting the anointing. You're prostituting the gifts of the Spirit, saints. And God will judge you. Judgment has come to the house of the Lord in this hour. And it will continue in 2020, saints. Because God has had enough. He has had enough. There are people out here who are dying. They're dying physically. They're dying spiritually. There are people out here who are hurting. There are people who need to hear the truth. People who don't even know how to go into the light. And we're busy selling seats. We're busy purchasing tickets and putting out registration fees instead of going out there and looking for the lost sheep and bringing them into the kingdom, saints, and we will be judged. He said, the ones that fall on the thorns, they are the ones that have a desire, he said. In 22, he says, now he who received the seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke out the word. Choke it out. They're still reciting scripture, saints, but they serve mammon. They're serving mammon, and they'll twist the word of God and make you think that you too can live like this. I don't want to live like that. That don't mean that God can't bless you financially. It doesn't mean that he won't give you things. But when you're entire, you call yourself a church, a ministry, a leadership, and your entire thing is revolved around money. What if that person couldn't come and afford your $90 registration fee for a prophetic conference? What if there was a homeless person that needed to come in and get saved and came in off the streets and they can't come in because they didn't get a ticket? You know, I think about that. It bothers me. And I constantly see it year after year after year, more and more and more and more people. And what's even more disturbing, saints, is that you all want to go follow these people. There are other upcoming ministers. We're setting a poor example in discipleship for newcomers, number one, and those who are striving to leadership, because they believe that they have to look just like you. And we tell them, they'll tell them, oh yeah, you know, and I know because people tried to tell me. Yeah, not too long ago, some years ago, they tried to tell me what I needed to do. Well, you want to be a platform? They tried, several male ministers try to tell me how they were going to help me build a platform so that I could become more well known than what I currently was. And I turned them down because I knew the God that I served. And when they realized that I was not going to go a certain direction, then they began to curse me and they began to shut me out their churches and call me false prophets and heretics and all of those things. But that's okay, saints. That's okay, because I want to stand before God with clean hands, because that's all that matters to me. Jesus told us not to build our treasures in this life. He said, don't build your, and he told the church of Laodicea to buy your gold from him, your linen from him. He let him anoint our eyes that we may be able to see, clothe us that our nakedness would not be exposed. I am not a citizen of this life. I am not, this is not my home. So, and everything that is here is passing away. So for those people who continue to build their luxuries on this life, I'm going to tell you flat out, this will, for some of you, this will be the only heaven that you know. This will literally be your only heaven that you know, because this is your heaven on earth. And along with that, and parallel with that, you're causing his little ones, his sheep, to fall astray because of your will. So he wants us to look. We need to really evaluate where we are in this season, saints. Listen, if you're on rocky soil, if you're on the thorny soil, you still can come out. Repent. Repent of your sins. Repent of your waywardness, of your rebellions, of your wickedness. Repent of your addictions to social media or whatever cares of the world is taking you away from spending time with the Savior, with the lover of your soul. Repent. That is the word, repent, because the kingdom of God is surely at hand. It is surely at hand, saints, and we must be ready, because if we are not ready, that shofar will sound and you will not hear it. And you will be left behind, saints. I want to talk about a few things dreams. I want to go over real quick with the time that I have left. I want to just tell you all that in 2019, I had a total of 5 dreams, one in February, one in June, which I shared that on a previous video regarding the detention camps and the borders being closed and the planes landing. Okay, I've talked about that. But since then, I had 3 more dreams in the month of December. Actually, I want to go back actually to the week of Thanksgiving, because that weekend of Thanksgiving, the Lord spoke to me. I don't know what time it was. It was nighttime though. And I felt the Spirit of the Lord, the presence of God hovering over me. Now, I've experienced that in the past. But it has been some years since I last felt that specific thing. It happened to me often in between 2013 and 2014, where I would wake up and I would feel the Spirit of God hovering over my body and he would speak to me. But I woke up and I felt it again. And I wasn't even completely awake, but my spirit man was talking to him, and I was like, Lord, I knew it was just like, Lord, that's you. And he said this to me. It was very clear. And he said simply, things will begin to accelerate at rapid speed now. That's what he said to me. He spoke that to me right the weekend of Thanksgiving. Then right after that, between Thanksgiving weekend and about Christmas, I'll say Christmas because Christmas and Hanukkah fell on the same, around the same week this past year, I had three dreams. And three dreams the Lord was showing me three times. Two of the dreams, I just want to say this, I saw a revolt happening in this country. And the revolt was amongst African Americans, okay? And part of the revolt, I saw them gathering together, strengthening accords, and there was a revolt. That's I can only give you that much of it. Except the other part, I want to tell you, I saw rallies. And the second dream, I saw three rallies, and they were not presidential rallies. But in one of the rallies, I saw a large group of African Americans together. And the speaker was African American, and the crowd was cheering or what have you, and there was security, and then someone opened fire. But the person that opened fire was it was within the security. It was a setup, it was a stage. And I just began to see bodies drop everywhere, all around me. Like I was there as a spectator to watch. And it was very frightening because it was very vivid. And I saw many bodies drop. It was like a mass shooting, but it was a setup. They planned this. It was strategically planned, not by the people going to the rally and not even by the guest speaker, at least I don't think, but the security around it. It was even like militant police, and someone opened fire on the crowd, upon the people. And I saw this happen three times, saints. It was terrible. It was really, really, really terrible. And then the last one I saw, the third dream, I saw towards the end of December, I saw militant police going into houses, and they were going house to house to house. They were pulling people out, saints. There were unmarked cars. The Lord actually froze the whole scene for me. And he told me to look around. Everything was frozen. It was literally like someone had pressed pause on a movie. And he told me to look. And I literally looked 360 degrees. And I was watching everything frozen. And I saw Black Hawk helicopters. I saw military police. I saw all of these things. But the Lord spoke to me. And he said, look for the unmarked cars. Tell them they're coming in the unmarked cars. So it's going to be unmarked vehicles. I know I've seen for years people put out videos, amateur videos, Facebook Live videos even of, you know, Humvees and UN cars or trucks or what have you on trains or lined up on the long of the road. And people are like, what are they doing? What are they doing? But I'm going to tell you, the Lord told me there will be unmarked cars. Which is similar to what he showed me in the summer in June, which I talked about in my other video, where I talked about how they quietly came and gathered the people because they knew where you were already. They knew what schools your kids went to, what church you go to. They knew about all of this. And I even touched on this, the Watchman on the Wall, because of them following us on our electronic devices and the fact that we're so silly enough to put all of our whereabouts on places like Facebook, okay, and videos of our children and inside of our homes and checkpoints at our churches and houses. We're so silly. And they're gathering all of this data. They're gathering all of this data, saints. I'll add a little extra thing to it. When you talk about data, two things have come out regarding the military and the government just in the last 2 weeks. Number one, the Pentagon was banned. Anyone in the Pentagon was banned from having the app TikTok. Now, I've seen it here and there. I've never like downloaded it, or my kids don't have it or anything like that. But they put out to the government employees, they're not allowed to have TikTok because they found that there was it's too easily targeted by, I believe it was Chinese hackers, or they were collecting the data somewhere in China on the people. And so the government employees, the federal employees, are not allowed to have TikTok on their phones. Then the other article that was put out that I've been saying for years was this whole DNA home testing kits, like 23andMe and Ancestry and all of these stuff, where you try to find out if you're 25% Indian and 5% African American and 50% Asian or whatever the case may be, right? I started telling people, because I knew people, even in my family, I knew people that did. I was like, listen, that I will not do that, because how do you know that they're not collecting your data? Well, the military has now been advised not to do the home DNA kits. Now that's something when the military is saying this, because of them collecting data on you, because, and they're saying it was a security risk. So they're telling the military, do not do these home DNA kits. All right. I want to put that we're too easy to give up our information again. We've become complacent. We're asleep with our eyes wide open, saints in America, and we've made it too easy for the enemy to come in and take us. All right. So these are the dreams that the Lord showed me. A revolt is coming. A civil war is coming. I just want to also mention a couple of things that have come to pass that is just really deep, say it's really, really deep. On September 20th, I put out a video, and you all can go back to my YouTube page and find this, where I talked about, it was called Israel, Iran, and the Spiritual Shift. And in this video, at this point, like I don't know, midway point towards the video, a little bit midway point, I talk about this dream that I had. The Lord had showed me an incident with Iran. And I talk about how I saw Americans being held captive. They were bound hand and foot, and they were taken hostage by Iranians. The people were speaking Farsi in the dream. They were Muslims, and they were speaking Farsi. And they were looking for someone who could interpret. There was a woman who spoke Farsi, but the man would not accept what she was saying, or that, or her help, I should say, specifically because she was a woman. And in that video, I talk about an impending situation that was going to arise between Iran and America. And you could go back and listen to it there. That has come to pass. I'm not even going to sit here and say that it's fulfilled, because right now, I know you all know within the last week what has transpired. What started in Iraq was they killed an Iranian leader, any Brock, who had burned down or attacked the U.S. embassy in Baghdad, that led to an airstrike that led to this high-end militant military leader's death, and then that sent shock waves across the Middle East. Riot protesting has risen in Iran. They're saying death to America. They've now dropped Israel and added that in there. And of course, Trump is gleaning over it. And let me just throw something in about that. You probably don't know this, but I found out that this specific military leader, two other presidents and a prime minister had been known about their whereabouts. And I'm going to tell you who they were. They were Bush, George W., Clinton, and Benjamin Netanyahu. And this is really interesting. They all had opportunities to kill this man, and they specifically chose not to. And their reasoning, and this is including Benjamin Netanyahu's reasoning, because they did not want a war. Now, I don't have a lot of time left, but I'm gonna tell you, you all, some people know, the Lord showed me that a war is coming. The last couple of years, he even told me 2 years ago on Yom Kippur of 2018, or actually 2017, he told me that a draft was coming. I just had someone recently say there's no draft coming. I see people mocking about that. The Lord told me that because my son actually wanted to go into the military. He was denied because of his respiratory issues. And I didn't think anything. I felt really sad about my son who had signed up. And I was in prayer, and the Lord began to speak to me about it. Like, I wasn't even talking to the Lord about the situation, but he began speaking to me and telling me about the situation with my son not being able to get into the military. And the Lord said, a draft is coming. That was the last thing he said to me. And in 2017, he said, a draft is coming. And I've been holding on to that. He says, and then a war is coming to me. And they know good. Of course, 2016, the Lord told me that a war was coming to Israel, and the war was coming to the Christians in America, and that it would be done after this administration placed certain things into effect, certain policies would go into effect, and then it would happen. I want to talk about something else, Saints, that is really interesting. You know, one of the things, I don't know how many videos I got out. It's not that many. I don't know, maybe 30, 40 videos, something, going all the way back to 2013 when I first started my YouTube page. You know, the Lord told me not to take any of these videos down. Even years later after, there were things that he gave me that I hadn't seen come to pass yet. And there was a point a few years ago where I was just like, well, God, I don't know. These things haven't come to pass yet. And he says, do not take anything down. Leave it up. He told me it was so clear. Listen, I just went back and I found a video that I did in March of 2014, Saints, and it was titled A Dirty War Is Coming. And I go on, you know, I mean, God, it's just, even looking back at myself from 6 years ago, it's like, whoa, I see such a difference, even in my own self. But it was in this video that the Lord spoke to me. And I talk about the Lord speaking to me, and he said we were 4 steps to nuclear war. And that was, I put it out in March of 2014. It's still up. It's titled A Dirty War, if you want to go back and listen to it from 6 years ago. Saints, I was on the phone with my assistant today, and I was completely blown away by this because I didn't know back then, 6 years ago, I was like, I didn't know what it meant. What does 4 steps mean? Does it mean 4 months, 4 weeks, 4 years? I didn't know anything. Like, I didn't really know. I was trying to do this research and look up the definition of dirty war. I remember talking about how something had happened within Argentina, which is interesting because Argentina is like in an economic collapse now. But I talked about Argentina and a dirty war that happened years ago. It's basically a war from within, like the government initiated the war from within, like a civil war, but it's considered dirty. Anyways, listen, 4 steps to nuclear war. 4 years after I put that video out, remember, I put it out in March of 2014, on March 1st of 2014, and you can go and Google and research this yourself. I was completely blown away this morning about this. Russia announced they made their announcement. It was like a commercial, a propaganda about them, their new nuclear warheads, specifically the hypersonic missiles, which I know you all, if you looked at any true news, real news, I'm not saying true news as in Rick Wiles, that's not what I'm talking about. But real news and the news reels, then you will see that they've been talking about this hypersonic missile thing for a couple years now. But I remember this. Some of you may recall this when Putin put this out and he had like this video where he showed how his missiles could hit different cities in the United States. It was like an amateur video, and one of the states was Florida. Go back and research it. He announced this on March 4th of 2014. Later on that year, on May 18th of 2014, the United States withdrew from their nuclear plan that included nuclear plans with Iran. Regarding Iran. Remember, the Obama administration had given Iran a nuclear deal in 2015, okay? So, and or excuse me, in 2015. And so in 2000 and or excuse me, in four, I mean not 14, I still seen it. And May 18th of 2018, 4 years later, okay, I said this wrong. We had pulled out of that deal that the Obama administration did in 2015. And that included Iran, of course, Russia, China, France, and the UK. I said March 1st of 2014. That is incorrect. It was March 1st of 2018 is when Russia made the announcement that they had the hypersonic missiles, and they did the whole advertisement where they showed them coming, his missiles being able to travel so fast and be able to hit different points of the US. I remember reading that article. Like it was in the news for like a week, okay? So 4 years after I put out that video in 2014, in March of 2014, about us being 4 steps to this nuclear war, 4 years later is when Russia and Iran and the US, everybody began to pull out of their nuclear deals, their nuclear, all of this stuff that they started talking about, the new arms race, which I know you all remember this because it was all in the news in 2018 and even in 2019, but especially in 2018, it was all of the news headlines. Is this a new Cold War? Is this a new Cold War? Is this a new Cold War? Because of the arms race, and then we had the issues, of course, with North Korea and all of that. 4 years later, and again, and so now here we are today, and right now, the article from just Sunday was saying that Iran made the announcement that they are not accepting any more nuclear deals with nobody. They are going to continue to move forward with their processing their enriched uranium, to produce nuclear warheads. Okay. Whew. We are here, Saints. I mean, like I said, it blew myself away with this. Within our country, and a couple more things I want to add before we go. A couple more things. I want to also talk about within our country, not only are we are facing this arms race, new nuclear arms race, whatever you want to call it, and war is literally knocking at our doorstep, which I did put also another video out a few months ago with the dragon. I saw a dragon being released upon the earth. Some of you all remember that. The little graphic is a thumbnail for the video where the Lord said it was a spirit of war. A spirit of war was being released over the whole planet. It wasn't just one country. It was over the whole planet, Saints. We're here. We're in this. We have got to wake up. You have got to stop listening to these people that are telling you peace and safety, blessings and prosperity. Someone put out that we had 10 more years of blessings in America. You all have got to stop listening to this stuff because it is a deception. And it's so important that we stop listening because if we do not, Saints, if we do not wake up, we're going to perish. I don't have no other way of saying this. I can't sugarcoat it. I can't tell you any other way, but people are going to die. That's just flat out. I just can't believe how caught up we are in the church. We just simply cannot see. The unbelievers can see. I hear heathens. I hear the youth, the millennials. They're talking about what is happening to our country. And how is it that the unbelievers and the youth see it, but the church doesn't see it? The evangelical church does not see it. It blows my mind away. 16 states, in case you don't know, I didn't even realize it was that many states until a few days ago. 16 states, Saints, have implemented the red flag law as of January 1st of 2020. Now, they started last year. If you do not know what the red flag law is, it is basically where someone can report you if you have any type of, if you have a weapon, a legal weapon, okay? I'm not talking about illegal weapons in the black market. I'm talking about you have a legal gun, a registered gun of some sort, whether it's for, personal protection or hunting or whatever, or collecting, whatever. Someone can report you if, and anyone, your neighbor, a teacher, the pastor, no, anybody, if they feel like you are a danger to yourself or someone else, they can report you. And if that report is investigated as legitimate, they will come and confiscate your weapons. It's actually become such a thing that Virginia is kind of in a frenzy right now, where several counties in the state of Virginia are trying to put up what they call sanctuary counties. Like they have the sanctuary states or cities, I should say, for the immigrants. They're trying to do sanctuary counties for the guns, okay? So if you are deemed, I need you to understand it, because there is so vague. It's so vague. Like they can just lie. They can make up stuff and say you're mentally incapable or you're an extremist or whatever, and they will come and take your guns away. This is part of the plan anyways. They're going to disarm us so that when martial law comes in, yes, I'm talking about martial law states. Listen, one of the things you guys have forgotten is that as of next month in February, we have been 1 year under a national emergency. Our president declared a national emergency in February last year. Now, he said it for the border, to get the money, the funding that he wanted to build the border. That money didn't come through and the border has not been built. And we are still under a national emergency. And if you guys don't understand the power that is under being placed in national emergency, I suggest that you research it. At any point, at any given point, the government can call martial law at any given point, because we can suspend elections. We can do whatever we want at any point because we're under a national emergency. And most Americans have forgotten about that. Okay. So you need to do that research as well. In regards to that, you know, another dream I want to talk about, because I'm starting to see so many things that God has given me. He gave me 6 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, that I thought, we all thought, other people who were listening thought, oh, this will come to pass at this particular president, this particular administration, this particular, and it didn't. And now it's coming to pass. Like here we are 5, 6 years later, and it's coming to pass. You know, I talk about how in 2016, the Lord gave me this dream. I call it my Daniel dream. I've spoken about it before, where I saw Russia and Turkey aligning themselves against the United States. And they aligned with some other countries. And there was this explosion that happened in these buildings. And I don't know, I didn't see any casualties or nothing. But through this, we were blamed, we being the United States. And then they teamed up together and they invaded us. And I saw the invasion coming in, but the sitting president for our country was not there. There was, the seat was empty. Okay, now I had this dream again in 2016 when Obama was still in office at the time. But you guys, here we are. Listen, we're here. We're here. I don't have any other things to say except we are here. 2020, saints, is the year of the sword. We're here. We're 6 days into the new year, and we're already talking about war. They crashed a military site because people are terrified of drafts. I've seen people on social media mocking and goofing off about this, and it just blows my mind that we are so desensitized in 2020. That now we can joke about a draft or joke about people who are panicking. We're laughing and mocking people. It's something that our parents and our grandparents would have never done and never imagined would be happening in this lifetime. But yet it is. We need to not play around with this. We need to not take God's mercy and grace for granted, saints, because we're in trouble. We are in trouble, and we're in trouble as a nation. Let me put it this way. And the only place to be, saints, is under the shadow of the Almighty, learning to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. The perfect place to be is in the perfect will of God. And you will not know the perfect will of God if you don't spend time with Him, if you're not listening to Him, if you're not hearing His voice. if you're caught up in everything else, you know, or if you're afraid of losing your stuff, you know, again, everybody wants to bank on Trump winning 2020 so they can keep more of their stuff. But you have to ask yourself, what if that doesn't happen? It actually doesn't matter if it happens or doesn't happen at this point, because if they do put him in office for another 4 years, which I think they will, it will cause such a civil uprising. We got people left and right, Saints, that are literally saying that they would fight to the death. They would be fine with the civil war. They would kill if they needed to. Whether if this president does not get into office or if he does, we got them from both sides of the spectrum, both sides. That's just how divided America has become. And you better not take that lightly, because like I said, the Lord has now shown me several dreams of people rising up and revolting. Even one of the people that I listened to, God's Healer 7, she put out a vision the other day where she saw people in concentration camps or detention camps, and she said they were all Caucasian, they were all white. And I was telling my husband, I said, the white evangelical church who is worshiping this president, I said, let me just put it this way. The people that are on the right wing, they're going to be considered a threat, Saints. But that's exactly what the Lord told me in 2016. He said, because they chose the man over me, he said, they will go into battle believing that I am with them and I will not be with them and many will perish. He said that to me in December of 2016, and I'm watching as these things unfold right before our eyes. There are people who are leaving the country. I have friends of mine, people I know personally, leaders, pastors, they're being told to leave the country this year. There are people who are being told to prepare and build safe havens and places of refuge. And there are people who are just going home. The Lord is taking them home, out of here. But we're not paying attention. A lot of us are not paying attention. We're too busy paying $90 to go to a prophecy conference for somebody to lie to us and tell us that everything's going to be okay when it's not going to be okay. And this is not fear mongering. This is not doom and gloom. And I'm going to tell you why it's not fear mongering, not doom and gloom, and I'll end it. It's not fear mongering because God said he's not giving us a spirit of fear. Okay. And nothing that I'm saying is to frighten you. It's to prepare you. Okay. Because if the Bible tells us, if you see trouble come, that was a warning that was given. He gave it to Ezekiel. If you see that trouble is coming and you do not sound the alarm and the people perish because of it, he said, I will hold you accountable. I do not want to be held accountable. It doesn't matter what you think of me. It doesn't matter what you say about me. It doesn't matter whether you think I'm real or not. It doesn't matter how many comments you leave or how many videos you put up about me being a false prophet. I don't care about any of that. All I care about is what God thinks of me. If I don't sound the alarm, I will be held accountable. I have to sound the alarm. But there's a time, Saints, where the alarm will not sound anymore. And we're coming to a close of that. Because if you notice, the prophets are going away. The voices are going away because there's only so much warning that we can do. And then there's no more warning. It's because the storm is here. It's no longer coming. It's here. Okay. And it's not doom and gloom because we are at the end of the age. These things were written. They were written before the foundations of the world. They must come to pass because it is written. There is nothing at the end of the Bible that says that, and they lived happily ever after on earth. No, not when we don't live happily ever after until the return of Jesus Christ comes. Okay. And even then he's here for 1,000 years and there's another battle. Okay. So we don't even get that part until the eighth day, the mystery of the eighth day, so to speak, after the millennial reign. But there's nothing that says that. Jesus said that brother would rise against brother. He said that we would be delivered up to be put in prison, to even kill the children, turn against their parents. Nation would rise against nation. The love of many would grow wax cold. Many would be offended. He told us all of this. He said they would hate us because they hated him. So if he told us that, If he said that we would be hated amongst many, and we see that Jesus, when he walked the earth, he made no reputation for himself. Why are we out here trying to get everybody to like us? Why are we out here trying to build these platforms and for us, and we want to be known, and we want to be under this covering and that covering, and we want to be, you know, standing next to this person, that person? That's why I said, Jesus said many times in the Gospels, he says, verily I say unto you, they will have their reward on earth. And they will not see, it won't be another reward. He said, this is the, like I said, for many, this will be the only heaven that they will know. Now, at the end of all of this, saints, with the beginning of the year, you have to understand, I want to leave you with a note of hope in this sense. And that is that God's desire is that no one should perish. His desire is that we all come to repentance. The Bible tells us that his mercies are renewed every morning. His grace is sufficient. And so if you're even watching this video today and you're shaken by it, or you're saying, I don't hear God, I don't know, you have the opportunity today to repent, to lay everything before him. Even if you're not sure, just tell him, God, I'm not sure. If you've been struggling in your sins, if you've been going around in circles, if there's secret sins that you know you haven't been delivered from, even if, you know, everything seems okay on the outside, but God sees the secrets of the heart. And some of you today have been struggling with secrets in your heart. Some of you have still not forgiven people who have come against you, who have hurt you, who have lied to you, abandoned you. You need to forgive. The Bible says we have to forgive in order to be forgiven. Today is the day to lay it down. Today is the day, saints, to forgive those who have come against you, have persecuted you, who have slandered you. Forgive them. Jesus hung on that cross. He said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And he still prayed for them. So we too are to forgive and lay people down at the cross. And repent of our sins. Repent of to turn away and not look back. And confess your sins. He says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just to forgive us. And he is, because he doesn't want you to miss the thing. He wants to speak to you. He wants to speak to your heart. Even today, Jesus wants to speak to your heart. He loved you. He's been calling you, and you've got to answer the call, because he said, seek me while I can yet still be found, and look for me. And he said, if you call out to me, I will answer you. Okay. And he said, I will deliver you out of trouble. That's in Psalm 91. So we've got to seek him today. You've got to answer the call. He's calling you by name. Answer the call. Answer the call and say, Lord, I'm here. Here I am. Just like Samuel as a little boy said, here I am, Lord. You have to say, here I am. Filthy rags and all, here I am, Lord. I lay it all before you today. I give it all to you today. I surrender my entire life to you today. Forgive me for my sins. Come into my heart. Wash me, purify me of all of my filth and transgressions and iniquities, and set my feet on solid ground. He will do it, saints. He will do it. I wanted to leave you with this today. God bless all of you all. And thank you for allowing me to be in your home today. Until next time, God bless you all and joy.